Hello and welcome to the first episode of Azure Architecture. My name is Esmail, and today with me I have Philip from Syncier. Philip is the head of architecture at Syncier Marketplace. And today he's going to talk about their hosted platform on Azure. And more specifically, he's going to talk about name resolution and DNS on Azure, and we will dive into their architecture. Hi, Philip. Thanks for coming.
Hi, Esmail. Thanks for introducing.
So, I would like to know why name resolution is so challenging and what challenges you have in your infrastructure.
Basic name resolution is not challenging at all, but with our setup, we had our DNS domain registered with a registrar that has no API for configuring it. So we had to do everything manually. That was a cumbersome process. And that was why we switched to Azure DNS, because our whole infrastructure is hosted on Azure. That was a...
Okay. And in terms of your architecture, what does it look like? Do you have a complicated architecture that requires, you know, automation and things like that?
Not complicated, but it's based on microservices on Kubernetes. So we have different services that are need to communicate internally as well as externally reachable. So that's why we use some features of the Azure DNS that are suitable for that.
Okay. And talking about your architecture, looking at your diagram, actually, can you tell us what Azure components and services are you using in your architecture, especially
sure.
to resolve those issues and challenges you have with name resolution?
So at first, we use AKS, the Azure Kubernetes service, like here. We use different AKS service for different purposes of our application. And for accessing the Kubernetes services from our on-prem environment for developer access, we use a VPN gateway from Azure that is in a point-to-site configuration mm-hmm. so that the internal user can connect to the cloud environment. And then we use the DNS zones of Azure. There are two. There are public DNS zones. You see it here. And there are private DNS zones that are here. And the feature with that is that you can have your domain, for example, xyz.com, hosted by the public DNS zone. And you can have the same domain, xyz.com, hosted by the private DNS zone. And the advantage of that now is that if your internet user wants to resolve your domain, he's coming to the public DNS zone and gets the public IPs resolved. And if your on-prem user connects to the VPN gateway, then he resolves to the private DNS zone and gets private IPs resolved for the same host names.
Okay, very interesting. And I see in your architecture, actually, you have different environments. You have the shared subscription and you have, of course, a project subscription.
Yes.
And as I see in your diagram, you even have different DNS zones, you know, in each subscription. What's the reason for really segregating this these DNS zones into separate environments? Why don't you have one?
That's because our companies split up in different ventures, and each venture has different product teams. And we wanted to make the public DNS zone for our Syncier.com domain as secure as possible, so not that many manipulations there. So we decided to go for subdomain zones that are hosted by the product teams themselves. So if you think about here, you have the abc.xyz.com and as well in the private zone. Then here you have the public DNS zone for abc.xyz.com. And to connect those two, you just need the NS entries over here. And then the name resolution for the abcxyz.com subdomain and any host in there is just redirected there and resolves the public IPs. And the same for the private DNS.
Okay.
So now you don't need access from the DevOps of that project for the public DNS zone of the domain itself, but they just need to connect to access to the public DNS zone of the subdomain.
So in that sense, you are also giving access to the public and private DNS zones of that project to the DevOps team themselves,
yes.
right? And they are managing it on their
yes.
own, and you only have the shared environment, which is managed by a core DevOps team.
Exactly.
You know, shared across the company.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Great, awesome. And in terms of the workload, I see you have AKS, because it might be interesting for some of our audience to know how you are handling name resolution within AKS, and also when it comes to the traffic coming towards your AKS as ingress. How do you handle name resolution there?
So we decided to go as close with Kubernetes standards as possible. So we use the standard core DNS inside Kubernetes, and we use Kubernetes services and an ingress. But for the outside communication, we are not using the standard Nginx ingress. We started with that, but it was cumbersome to configure together with the DNS entries on the public DNS zone. So we use a special feature that is available in Azure that's called an App Gateway Ingress Controller. Mm-hmm. So it's an Azure managed application gateway that manages the ingress inside Kubernetes. So it's mm-hmm. a different resource inside Azure, but it's connected to one cluster. And now we have the possibility to just define our ingresses, and the app gateway makes the host-based routing. So if the user, again, the internet user, comes from the public DNS zone and wants to connect to our app, then he resolves to the public IP of the app gateway, and app mm-hmm. gateway makes the host name-based routing into the services of the Kubernetes.
Mm-hmm. I see that then your DNS zones, either public or private, in the project subscription are containing A records of
yes.
your resources within the AKS cluster. Is that true?
Yes, that's okay. true. So if we have here an app dot abc.xyz.com, this is an A record pointing to the public IP of the app gateway. And the app gateway then makes the host-based name resolution into the Kubernetes, and then core DNS takes over.
Okay, I see. And how are you handling actually dynamic update of those A records inside your DNS? So
for that, we are using external DNS, and that's integrated with the app gateway ingress controller. So it's just an annotation inside an ingress definition, either Helm or with Kubernetes YAML resource files. And we are using cert manager as well for getting Let's Encrypt certificates for that for those hosts. And this is now fully automated. So you just deploy it once in your AKS, and then you just use standard Kubernetes resources, and everything is automated. And the beauty of that setup is if you have liveness and readiness probes defined in your Kubernetes pods, then those are taken by the app gateway as backend health indicator. So fully integrated, you don't have to define anything or configure anything in the app gateway itself.
Okay, thanks, Philip, for sharing that with us.
Thanks, Ismail, for hosting me.
Thanks for being with us, and I hope you enjoyed the show. Thank you.
Thanks as well. Bye.